how the ancient civilization of Kush could conquer Egypt and then virtually disappear is a mystery that Pearce Paul Creasman and his team from the University of Arizona are helping to solve. They're about to enter the burial chambers beneath the pyramid of King Nastasen, the last Kushite king to be buried here at the Royal Cemetery of Nuri, and whose tomb now lies submerged beneath the waters of the Nile.
Underwater archaeology in Sudan, this is the first time it's been attempted.
Now, the question on Pearce Paul's mind is, does the tomb still contain the undisturbed remains of this ancient Kushite ruler? As the team prepares to enter the first chamber, the small doorway serves as a reminder of the dangers.
Overnight, a little bit of the door collapsed, so it required some protective efforts to just make sure our way in and out is always our way in and out. Because if something collapses, there's only two people with a way to get us out, and that's us.
Cut into the solid rock beneath the pyramid lie three burial chambers. The first, just beyond the submerged doorway, was explored by George Reisner a century ago.
You go through the little entranceway and you get shot through into the first chamber.
The first chamber is a vaulted ceiling. You know you're in a tomb. And then you shine your lights and see exactly what Reisner described.
From the first chamber, Reisner could see that the second had suffered a major ceiling collapse and decided it was too dangerous to continue.
It was a 5 meter or 15 foot collapse of material down on top of the chamber.
At least there you could kind of stand up and take a breath and get your bearings a little bit. And then you see that tiny black entrance to the third chamber in front of you.
Looking in the third chamber, we're looking into the unknown. We know nothing about it. And we stood there and considered the possibilities of what might be on the other side of the door under the wall.
Are you ready to go to Nastasen's burial chamber 15?
I'm so excited.
I know. Yeah, I can see it on your face.
The third chamber offers the incredible prospect of discovering King Nastasen's remains. But this is a high-risk environment.
So we didn't go into the third chamber immediately. We had to set up a guideline with lights. It's very easy to get disoriented. It's basically an underwater cave.
Are you okay?
Yeah, it's just really sludgy here now. I'm hard time getting footing.
There's no light, there's no air except what you bring in, or what little bit might have been left in an air pocket. So, first things first, safety.
Only when he's happy that it's safe to go on will Pearce Paul resume his quest to meet King Nastasen. For 1,000 years after its beginnings in 2500 BC, the Kushite Empire of Kerma grew powerful enough to rival the success of Egypt. But what was the source of this great wealth and power? One of the most distinctive hallmarks of Kerma's sophistication was its mastery of glazed ceramics.
The site is still contain many archaeological sites and evidence that showing the date of Kerma. This is dated to 2500 before Christ. It is the best quality of ceramic all over in Africa.
Producing ceramics on this scale would have required an army of skilled artisans, something which only a hugely prosperous and successful city could support.
Like any ancient state, Kerma derived some of its wealth just from agriculture. But absolutely without question, a major part of their wealth was serving as middle traders between inner Africa and Egypt.
Harnessing the River Nile as an ancient superhighway, Kerma grew immensely wealthy, satisfying Egypt's insatiable appetite for high-value goods.
Gold, different spices, ivory, ebony, slaves also coming from the south.
For centuries, the constant ebb and flow of this trade along the Nile provided a strong bond between the two rival empires.
At the beginning, it was friendly.
All the time, the trade routes were open, even during conflict. I think both sides are benefit from each other, so it's very important for them to keep trade.
But like many closely matched neighbors, these two superpowers also harbored a deep mutual distrust.
I mean, from the very beginning, Kush was regarded in Egypt as an enemy, officially, in the official ideology. But at the same time, there's lots of evidence that people moved back and forth freely across the borders. There was settlement. So they traded, they intermarried, and they fought.
As Kerma grew in power and stature, the Egyptians viewed their Kushite rivals with increasingly envious eyes. In response, the city of Kerma shored up its defenses.
In the northeastern corner, there is one of the military camps surrounding by a big wall. This camp is towards the Nile and towards Egypt to protect the city from the Egyptians.
Around 1500 BC, during Egypt's 18th dynasty, tension between the two empires reached its peak. In an attack led by Pharaoh Thutmose I, the royal kingdom of Kerma was destroyed and its magnificent capital city burnt to the ground.
Thutmose destroyed all the cities. He burned the palaces and the Fufa and the round temple. We can see clearly the mark of this firing. It still exists in the building itself.
How the people of Kush fared under five centuries of Egyptian rule is a mystery archaeologists are just beginning to solve.